Shilpa ji, Shadul bhai, friends from financial world of this country. First of all, thank you very much for inviting me to this annual capital market conference. As a Department of Investment and Public Asset Management, I probably interact maximum with the capital markets in my day-to-day performance and activities. So I definitely, like all of you, have a lot of interest in capital markets, how they are growing, where we are placed globally, and what is the future and map forward. Well, when Government of India, this current government, assumed charge, there was a promise of shaping Indian economy into a very globally competitive economy. And India reinforced its position as the fastest growing economy in the world for the last few years. In spite of challenges and major reforms, major long-lasting reforms which government decided to take. So this economy is largely driven by four or five major thrust areas. One is that it is committed to improve macroeconomic fundamentals of the economy, and whatever hard steps are required to be taken, government is not feeling shy in taking those steps. You can see a large number of reforms, including medium and long-term reforms, which have long gestation periods. But government is committed to take these reforms, which are essential for the nation building, not in a very short run, but in terms of long-term growth and stability of this country. Then there had been tremendous focus on cashless and digital economy. I headed a task force from March 2016, and the way it is being driven, the commitment of the government to create cashless and digital transaction society is phenomenal. Lot of instruments, lot of framework has emerged, and lot of work is yet to be done. Then to create a favorable investment climate, attracting investment domestically and from every source globally to invest in Indian economy and catalyze growth. And last but not the least, to create a very transparent, robust regulatory framework, which is essential in any case for capital market and all the markets. The outcome so far is that India is continuing to be the best investment destination in the world today. There is upsurge in terms of volume and depth in the equity market and debt instruments. And the foreign investment inflow has never been so stable in this economy. I can say, barring the period of November-December, period of demonetization, when there was an outflow, there had been a constant inflow of foreign investment in this country. If we just see how capital market has been performing, first of all, it's very well regulated, transparent capital market, where any investor has freedom to come in and go out at absolute ease. The rules of the games are very transparent. They are not favorable only for inflows and somehow obstructing the outflows. So a lot of confidence is there. If you go by World Economic Forum Global Competitiveness Report of 16-17, India is ranked 38th in terms of development of capital. It is better than Brazil, better than China. It is among best performing capital markets, and if you see the equity capital market in last two decades, it has given you a CGR of 11.1%. Such phenomenal return is not visible in any other capital market. Over 250 and odd companies have market cap of $1 billion, which are listed in the stock exchanges. It's a highly liquid market. Nearly $4 billion of cash trade taking place every day, with the market capitalization touching nearly $2 trillion. Even in the derivative segment, it is fastest growing market. Nearly 2 billion contracts are being done every day, with a value of $10 billion or so. If you see 2016, it was probably one of the best years for IPOs. Nearly $4 billion of US dollars were raised through IPOs, and there were 26 IPOs where the size of the issue was more than $25 million. So that type of activity in capital market is phenomenal and very promising. Interestingly, in the capital market, if you see by one report in March 17, nearly 62% was the holding by DII as compared to FII. 62% of the FII holding was in the hands of DII. So there had been large inflows of DII in the capital market in the last 1.5 years. It is visible when you see the performance of various offerings in the market. Now, in terms of FDI, we see how we are able to attract investments. So India, I said, is one of the most promising destinations. In the last 2 years, year after year, nearly $36 billion had been FDI inflows. From 2008 till March 2016, the FII inflows were to the tune of $103 billion. And in Asia Pacific region, the next best destination was Taiwan, attracting nearly $45 billion. So that is the type of attractiveness. And if you see 2017, the net inflows had been $7.6 billion. During March 17 itself, there had been a net FII inflows of nearly $8.6 billion. So that is the type of interest which is being seen in the Indian capital markets. In terms of competitiveness of our capital market, we are ranked 39th in a group of 128 countries as per the World Economic Forum reports. Now, what is the government approach and what is the CPSE disinvestment approach or investment management approach that also governs a lot of activity in the capital market? The big two companies are CPSEs, Coal India and ONGCs. And the approach has changed dramatically from pure disinvestment of government entities to management of investment in the central public sector enterprise. When we talk about management of investment, government also looks in CPSEs their investment as an investor within the overall framework of national policy and national priorities. After all, government is the investor. And when we are listing and when we are sharing this wealth with the other investors, we have to be mindful that companies are performing well, they have good market cap, they are servicing the investment very well. Probably government is the only entity which has a very transparent policy to service capital. We came out with capital restructuring and capital management policy in May 2016, which largely gives you a sense how government will expect than central public sector enterprises to service their investors by way of dividend, bonus share, market cap, other initiatives. If they have a lot of cash, then why not buy back if they are not able to put it to good business use? And you have seen over a dozen of buybacks have taken place in public sector space, which were not happening earlier. Government also announced a policy of time-bound listing of the CPSEs. Almost a dozen of CPSEs, which are good, big-sized profit-making companies, which are not listed, are in the process of entering the market at appropriate time. But the commitment to list them is visible. We have already come out with two IPOs, Hudco and Cochin Shipyard. And the confidence of investor in IPOs of the CPSEs is well demonstrated by these two issues. Issues of the size of 1200 to 1400 crore, we had applications of money pouring in over a lakh of crores for each issue. So that is the type of investor confidence in CPSE space. And the commitment of the government that we will be looking after these investments more in terms of its economic performance within the overall national objectives gives them further confidence to look into these investment opportunities. So Government of India is following four tracks on management of investments. One is minority stake sale, where we are committed to go to 51% and in the financial institution up to 52%. And we will not be ceding management control in such cases. So those companies which are of strategic importance, that is what we are doing. The companies which are not listed, we are following a track of listing. I said that over a dozen companies are getting, and they are all sectors, defense, railways, insurance, they are all entering the market. So bold decision by government to invite participation of investors in sensitive sectors which are otherwise it was felt that they should not be listed in the stock exchanges. I said defense, railways, insurance, all the three are very major sectors. Then we are coming over a dozen and a half companies, one and a half dozen companies we have identified where we are suggesting a strategic sale, where we are likely to enter into the market, offering 100% or more than 50% equity or even less than 50% with the management control, meaning thereby government will exit from the management of these companies. But one thing should be very clear here. Which are these companies and what is the purpose of a strategic divestment? The idea of a strategic divestment is not that government doesn't want to run these companies. Rather, we feel in these areas, in these sectors, a lot of growth has come in the private sector. A lot of players are there. And in the hands of the government, probably the best economic value of these companies is not being exploited. Either these companies need more investment or some technology tie-up, so some technology gaps are there, and maybe managerial efficiencies in the private hands is much better because lot of such companies are operating in the private domain, and when we compare their performance with common companies, we feel there is a lot of scope for improvement. So these strategic divestments or privatization, which we normally call, or government ceding management control, is purely for the purpose of expansion of the business in these sectors. The best economic value should be unlocked, more investment should come in these companies, and these companies should be allowed to grow exponentially, which they are probably not growing today in the government hands, and they are pure business opportunities, so why not pass it on to one who can run it better, expand it better. So these companies are being divested for growth. Then government is committed for professional management, both in terms of economic performance as well as governance issues. So listing brings a lot of transparency, compliances. Now, if what we had been doing in divestment in government was generally the OFS. So now with the policy of capital management or investment management, all possible options are being excised. You have seen buybacks, you have seen bonus, large number of bonus shares being issued by CPSEs. You have seen a lot of splitting of shares taking place. You have seen a lot of conversion into reserve to capital base. Large number of IPOs are hitting the market. Then we even revitalized the ETF market. It is one of the fastest growing asset class in the world. And in India, if you see, Government of India created first CPSE ETF in 2013-14. Came out with the NFO, which was subscribed, oversubscribed by 1.5 times. But we probably did not use this instrument. In January 2017, CPSE ETF came out with a big FFO tranche. It was almost $895 million. It was oversubscribed 2.3 times, and the retail was oversubscribed 7 times. We came out with that FFO2 also in March, that was also oversubscribed 4 times. And in 1 year, the AUM in the ETF segment has almost doubled. So Government of India, seeing the interest of investors and committed to share the wealth of the CPSEs with the public and institutions, has announced another Bharat 22, which have 6 sectors. It has banks, it has private companies where Government of India is holding equity, it has CPSEs, 6 sectors, none of the sector having a weightage of more than 20%, none of the individual company having more than 15% weightage. 22 companies are there, and expense ratio less than 1 basis point. So attractive for retail investors. 1 basis point is no money. So Bharat 22 has also been announced by Honorable Finance Minister. Nutshell, we are committed for stable, transparent, well-regulated growth of capital market. We will continue to manage investment in CPSE space and other companies in such a manner that it really catalyzes activity in the capital market. And we partner with all the investors in the growth story of this country. Thank you.